Hello everyone, this is Pastor Brian, coming to you again, not from Union Presbyterian Church, but from my home studio. Still having to record from home, sort of a reasonable facsimile of what we did this morning at our Thanksgiving service at Union. I must tell you, it's been a little difficult getting this set up for today. For some reason, Everything that could go wrong did go wrong. I think that's called Murphy's Law or something like that. But I think this is going to work, although I can never tell until after I've finished recording and sort of play it back. But Lord willing, this will work. Let's begin today by asking God's blessing as we worship together. Heavenly Father, on this Thanksgiving weekend and this Thanksgiving Sunday, we are so grateful, Lord, that we can come together via the internet. We can connect with each other and you can bless us together as we look into your word. As we together lift up the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our Lord and our Savior and our coming King. We're looking forward to that day when we shall at last see him face to face and our faith will give way to sight. What a glorious day that will be, as the hymn writer says, when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through that promised land. What a day, oh glorious day, that will be. There'll be no sorrows there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no more pain, no more parting over there, when forever we shall be with the one who died for we. What a day, glorious day that will be. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all that you've done for us, all that you've promised to do for us. Help us in these trying times, Lord, to fix our eyes on Jesus, to take our eyes off of the things of the world and those in the world who would try to weigh us down and lead us astray, discourage us along the way. Lord, help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Thank you, Heavenly Father, with all of our heart for the incredible gift of your Son. And today, Father, we lift up our own families on this special day. We thank you for them. Thank you for the privilege of having a family and raising children. It is such a wonderful privilege. And for those who are not blessed with children, Lord, there are so many other things for which to be thankful today. And help us to focus on those things for which we are thankful and to commit into your loving care those things that we aren't so thankful for, but we commit into your care. Lord, we thank you for being free and safe in this part of the world, but we know that there are so many difficulties, so many horrors happening in other parts of the world today. And Lord, we thank you that you're looking upon these things And all we can say is, your will be done. We don't understand. We can't even begin to understand. But Lord, we want to say today, we trust you, Heavenly Father. We trust you. And together we commit ourselves into your loving care. And now, Lord, as your family, together help us to pray the wonderful prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we have forgiven those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, let's read the scriptures I want us to think about today. We're going through, continuing our sermon series through the Gospel of Matthew today. And today we land at chapter 4, and we're reading from verses 12 to 17. And then we're going to jump for a few verses over to chapter 14, verses 12 to 14, and there to get sort of the rest of the story that we started in chapter 4. So here we go. When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, that's John the Baptist, by the way, when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he returned to Galilee. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which was by the lake, in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said through the prophet Isaiah, land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way to the sea along the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Then chapter 14. John's disciples came and took his body and buried it. Then they went and told Jesus. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed those who were ill. May the Lord help us today as we consider his word together. Well, I don't know what time of day it is, where you are right now, or what you're doing right now, but I'm glad you've tuned in again to our wee broadcast here. I want to start off today by asking you a question. It's a personal question, but well, maybe not so personal, but we'll see. I say not so personal because I think everyone's answer is going to be the same. But here's the question anyway, and to make it really easy, it's multiple choice. I like that kind of test. Here's the question. In your life, what is most important to you? In your life, what is most important to you? Is it money? Or prestige? Or getting a great job? Or having power over others? Or is it family? I'm pretty sure everyone watching is going to say, oh, without a doubt, family. Nothing else comes close. This morning, the thing I am most thankful for, of course, is my own precious family, and I am so thankful for them. And right behind that, for those of you who are watching who are from Union Church, right behind them is my Union Church family. All of you, near and far, I'm thankful for you. This, by the way, is an interesting time of the year for our Union Church family because we're coming to that point when we have to get the budget together for next year. And then in November, the congregation will be asked to ratify the budget that has been proposed. Personally, I'll be glad when all that's over with. I hate talking about finances. You know, finances to me are something to be avoided. I don't like talking about them about the same way I like talking about a pandemic or a plague or something. So I said this morning when I preached this sermon that I wouldn't be talking about money, but as I went along, it turned out that, well, actually I was talking about money, but in a sort of different way, not you know, the money that you and I have. Today it's all about Jesus. And you know what? It's always all about Jesus. It should be in every sermon that's preached from every pulpit in the world every Sunday. It should all be about Jesus and Jesus only, our Lord and our Savior. There's a lovely, I guess, sort of modern hymn I like very much. In fact, I like it so much that it's one of those that I wish I'd written myself. I have written a few songs, but not this one. This is what the words say. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it cost to bear my sin upon that cross. No, I'll never know how much it cost to bear my sin upon that cross. That's why we are here today, to worship the one who bore our sin, who bore my sin and yours on that cross so long ago. Paul the Apostle understood this well, of course, and he wrote in his second letter to the Corinthians in chapter 9, verse 15, a very simple sentence. He said, "Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift." The old King James Version says, "his unspeakable gift." I guess that's kind of interesting, because it says we don't have words. There's nothing we can say. It just can't be done. The gift is so great, so awesome, given to us. So we are thankful today, Lord Jesus, for all that you've done for us. In his ministry, I don't know if you realize this or not, but in his ministry, you would think that Jesus would have spent a great deal of his time talking about the future, about heaven, about the wonderful things to come. But you know what? Jesus was very much in touch with real people, just like us. And because money concerns us so greatly nowadays, it always has, I guess it always will. You know, how to get it, how to get more of it, having got it, how to hang on to it. And really, for most ordinary people, sadly, it's simply how not to run out of it before the end of the month. Jesus understood about money, and so he spoke more about money in everything that he said in the Gospels, more about money than he ever did about heaven. It's really quite amazing. No one could ever say that Jesus was so heavenly minded that he was no earthly good. That's for sure. He understood the importance of money. He grew up poor. He grew up in a poor family. He wasn't the prince. He became the King of Kings. That's who he is now. But when he was growing up on earth, a humble carpenter's family, as we all have heard. Jesus, although he knew the importance of money, he himself personally was never obsessed by it. Never. And maybe that's one of the reasons that he was the Prince of Peace, because he didn't lose any sleep worrying about money. One of the most curious and somewhat perplexing things about Jesus is that when he left home at age 30 and started his ministry, we have to remember that when he did that, he walked away from his family. He had an earthly family. There was Mary and Joseph, and the scriptures tell us that he had four brothers, their names are given, and it says sisters, so we don't know, it says all of his sisters, so he had at least two sisters. So counting Jesus, that would be seven kids. That's an awful lot of mouths to feed. And of course, remember that Jesus must have been the head of the house by this time. In fact, long before he reached the age of 30. Because Joseph, his earthly father, completely drops out of sight in the scriptures after Jesus' 12th birthday. So it seems that, we don't know for sure, but it seems that Joseph died young and left Mary a widow. And Jesus, as being the eldest of her family, it was cast upon his shoulders to carry on the family business that Joseph had taught him. Carpentry, building, stoneworking, all of the things that a tradesman would do. That's what Jesus did. And he looked after his family until such time as the other kids were all grown up and they could take responsibility. And at that point, Jesus just walked away. And he spent the rest of his life with, now get this, absolutely no income whatsoever. You talk about living by faith. He asks us to live by faith. Well, he didn't have a job. He didn't have any income. He lived by faith too. He always never asked us to do anything that he wasn't willing to do himself. Always remember that. He walked in our shoes. He knows. And at age 30, when he did this, one important thing I always want us to remember, God's timing is always perfect. And so at just the right time, Jesus left. It was God's timing. And we'll see how important God's timing is as we carry on a little bit today. God's very concerned about timing, by the way. Even Jesus is coming into the world. It was at just the right time in history. Paul writes to the Galatians in chapter 4, and he says, "But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those under the law." That's us. Under the law, a law that we could, the thou shalt and thou shalt nots that we could never possibly ever keep. Never. We could never keep the whole law of God. We could never earn our way to heaven. Absolutely impossible. God sent his son at just the right time to rescue us, to rescue this world. And so, especially my Union Church family who may be watching, take this to heart. And all of you who are watching today, take this to heart and be encouraged by this. At just the right time, Jesus will come again. He promised he would. At just the right time, he's going to come again back to this earth, and he's going to take us home. He's going to take us home to heaven. What a day, as I've already said today. What a day, glorious day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. Everything that's weighed us down, that's caused us to stumble and have heartaches and pain, everything will be forgotten when Jesus comes. It's all about Jesus. Always. Jesus knew all about families. He grew up in one. He knew all about family life, and he taught us some really important things about family love. And we're going to think about family love today as we go through this. Not only love, but duty. Love and duty. It's pretty hard to separate those two things. If you really love, then duty becomes natural. Jesus showed us by example how to have love for family, and at exactly the same time to fulfill his duty to the lost people around him. Now, with all of that as background, we're going to look at those verses we read from Matthew chapter 4, and then the rest of the story in Matthew chapter 14. How am I doing on time here? Oh, well. One thing about doing this on the internet, you can just fast forward whenever you want. I hope you don't, but you can. So I'm not going to worry about time. It's easy to miss something about Jesus. Not as the Son of God, but I have to remember that he was a human being as well. 100% God. God in flesh. He said that if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. I and the Father are one. Jesus said that. God with us. That was the Lord Jesus when he came to this earth. Excuse me, but we have to also remember that he was also a human being. He was 100% human. Is also being 100% divine. Friends, I'm going to pause this just for a second because I'm about to have a coughing fit. I'll come right back. Where is the pause button? Hello, I'm back. Sorry for that interruption. I don't have a cold, and I'm certainly not contagious. I'm just having a little problem lately breathing. Nothing, you know, nothing serious at all. I'll be fine. Now, I was saying that Jesus was 100% divine, God in human form, but he was in human form. And so he had exactly the same kind of a body as we have. And exactly the same kind of feelings and I suppose aches and pains when he pulled the muscle, you know, everything that we go through as well. So, as a man, as a human, but also as a family man who loved his family, his extended family, which, by the way, as we'll find out, included John the Baptist, who was a cousin. The first thing Jesus said in his public ministry was something very solemn. It sounds pretty harsh. He said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." Repent. People don't like to hear that. It sounds, like I said, it sounds harsh. And you might say, well, where's the love there? And shouldn't he start off talking about, I love you so much that everything's going to be fine. Just trust me. No, he starts off by saying, repent. Change your ways, turn around, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Jesus was incredibly good working under pressure. He handled it so well. Love on the one hand, duty to others on the other. Love for family, love for his own, duty towards others. He handled this so well. I wish we could all do that, don't you? At least on my part, I wish I could. Handling pressure is really hard. Jesus was a family man, yes, but he was God's man. He God in the flesh. But you know what I mean. He had responsibilities to both. And yet because he had responsibilities to preach, he started with this, that one sentence sermon. I bet you wish that my sermons were one sentence long. Well, don't hold your breath. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. The thing to note here is he said those words, he preached that first short sermon right after John, his cousin, right after John was thrown into prison. Exactly then, Jesus takes up where John left off. John's message was, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. And he said to the people, come and publicly get baptized and show everyone that you're being symbolically washed of your sin and you intend to live a different life from now on. Repent, change your ways. That was what John said, but now John was in prison and he was now silenced. He was going to die in prison. He was going to be cruelly executed in prison not too long into the future. So his ministry was over. And Jesus took up exactly where John left off, with exactly the same message, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. It must have been gut-wrenching for Jesus. He knew John. They were only about 6 months apart or so in age. John was a little bit older. They probably grew up together. They probably went their own ways later on. John went down to live around Jerusalem. Jesus stayed up in the north and around the Sea of Galilee. But they knew each other so well. And now, here's John, thrown into prison. He did nothing wrong. He's thrown into prison. He's going to be executed. Why didn't Jesus say something? Instead of preaching and saying to people, repent, why didn't he start saying, join me and let's revolt against the government. No, he didn't do that. He said, as emotional for him as it must have been, he set aside those feelings, those emotions, and he stuck to the duty that he was sent to do, to turn people to God. Jesus thought so highly of his cousin John. John was very special. We know Jesus' birth was a miracle. Mary was a virgin, but John's birth was also, it wasn't a miracle, but it certainly was miraculous, because it says very, very clearly in the scriptures, it says where the angel Gabriel is talking to Mary, and he says, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. So it was a miraculous thing. Elizabeth was way beyond the change of life, way beyond her childbearing years, and yet she got pregnant. Amazing. John was a very, very special. In fact, so special that Jesus later said, and Matthew records it in chapter 11, actually, Jesus is speaking and he says to the crowd there, truly I tell you, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Wow, what an accolade, what a wonderful thing to say about someone. There's never been anyone like him. Wow. So, Mary was a virgin. Her cousin Elizabeth was too old to conceive. Once again, as I said before, never, never question God's timing. Never question what God can do, never. So now we have a very much better idea of how Jesus felt when he heard. Remember the scripture says he heard that John was in prison, and he later found out that John had died. And he died by having his head chopped off. Gruesome. But it's true. It's in the scriptures. It says so. John was beheaded by a despotic, wicked, horrible man who was untouchable because he was a king. He was a grandson of, you remember that original King Herod in the Christmas story? Well, this is one of his grandsons, Herod Antipas, a horrible person. And he had Jesus, had John the Baptist beheaded. Horrible. Well, John's mission was over. His mission was to prepare the way for the Lord, and now the Lord, the Messiah, Jesus, he was here. So John's mission was complete. God's timing was not flawed. But the mission of Jesus, that was not complete. And it wouldn't be complete for another, 3.5 years or so. Someone has said, and I tried to remember the exact quote, and I tried to quote it this morning, but it goes something like this, and it's so true. It said that Jesus had to die the sin-atoning sacrificial death that we could never do. Why? Because Jesus was pure, sinless, we could never die a death like that, because a death like that would mean nothing, because we're sinful. So Jesus died a death that we could not die in order to pay a debt that he did not owe and that we could never pay. Imagine, if you will, how Jesus felt. He must have felt when he heard that that wicked king had murdered innocent John the Baptist. The king couldn't be touched. He could never be brought to justice. Do you think Jesus had an overwhelming feeling of peace about it? Well, what does Matthew tell us? When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, that's down around Jerusalem in the south. When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he returned to Galilee. He traveled all the way back up north to the north part of the country. Back to, it says, leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum. So some time had passed. He went to Nazareth. That's where he was brought up, right? Jesus the Nazarene. And then he went to live in Capernaum. That was right on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And that's where Peter and the other fishermen disciples lived. So what did Jesus do? Boy, he went back to work. John had been in prison. Jesus knew he would never get out alive again. And now he had been executed. What did Jesus do? Did he lead a protest march, as some would today? Did he lead a protest march against the government and the king? Down with the king, down with the government. No, he didn't. He didn't do that. He went back to Nazareth, back to work in Capernaum. He went back to work. He went on preaching good news of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. He went back to healing broken bodies, to healing broken minds, and mending broken hearts. That's what he did. And dear friends, that's what he still does today. That's what he is willing to do, longing to do for you today. If you'll just let him, if you'll just trust him, if you'll just give your heart to him, let him heal it for you. He'll do it. Chapter 14 of Matthew tells us, John's disciples came, took his body and buried it. Then they went and told Jesus. When they had heard what had happened, when he had heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat into a private, solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed, he saw a large crowd. He had compassion on them, and he healed those who were ill. Did you see that? Can you picture that? John was now dead and buried. Jesus didn't hear anything about it until it was all over with. He didn't even get a chance to attend the funeral for his beloved cousin and friend. The one he thought so highly of. That was taken away from him. Imagine how you would feel. Imagine how I would feel if that happened to us. They didn't tell Jesus till it was all over. And you notice in the text it says, only then, when it was all over and done with, Jesus tried to take some time to grieve the loss of his cousin, of his dear close friend. He said he went to a private, solitary place just to be alone, just to grieve on his own. But the crowds followed him. They didn't give him the chance, because there were lost people who desperately needed him. And friends, there are lost, hurting people today. Maybe you are one of them. who desperately need Jesus today. What did Jesus do? It said he had compassion on them and he healed those who were ill. Jesus is full of compassion. He's longing to give you his heart and to change your life completely, to be your savior, to be your friend. Oh, dear friends, give your heart to Jesus today. Love and duty. That was the sermon title today. Jesus showed us how to do both. And that's another reason we love him. He doesn't just tell us what to do. He shows us how and then he does it. Lord Jesus, we love you. And as Paul said once again, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. God bless you, my friends. I trust that your Thanksgiving is or was a wonderful time together with your family and with your close friends. May he bless you abundantly today. And Lord, I won't see you next week or the week after. I'm taking a break. Someone is filling in for me at the church next Sunday morning. And then the weekend after that, on the 27th, we won't have a service at Union because our North Halton Presbyterian churches will be joining together in Acton at Knox Church Acton. There for a joint service together. So there won't be another video coming from me until the first Sunday, Lord willing, the first Sunday in November. Until then, God bless you. May he lift up his face upon you, give you peace, fill you with thanksgiving and joy. God bless you all. See you next time.